Hello and welcome to the International Daily Roundup with People's Dispatch, where we bring you some of the top stories from across the globe. Let's take a look at today's headlines. Honduran court convicts Roberto Castillo for the murder of activist Berta Cáceres. Attacks and arrests of pro-democracy protesters continue in Swaziland. COVID-19 crisis worsens in Indonesia amid oxygen and vaccine shortages. And in our final story, we take a look at the protests against the UK government's policing and crime bill. A court in Honduras has convicted Roberto David Castillo in the assassination of activist Berta Cáceres. Castillo is a US-trained former intelligence officer. He was also the head of the energy company Desarrollos Energéticos, or DESA, D-E-S-A. The company held a contract to build the Agua Zarca Dam on the sacred Gualcarque River. Berta Cáceres was an indigenous activist who had led the struggle against the project. The dam had been approved even though it did not comply with national, international, or community guidelines. The project would have flooded surrounding areas and cut off food, medical, and water supplies for the indigenous Lenca people. Cáceres filed official complaints against the project and organized a blockade to prevent construction. She received years of threats for her participation in the struggle. On March 2, 2016, Cáceres was shot and killed inside her home in La Esperanza. Roberto Castillo has now been found guilty as a co-conspirator in her assassination. The High Court in Tegucigalpa announced the verdict on July 5th after a 49-day trial. The court ruled that Castillo had used paid informants and military contracts to track Cáceres. He also arranged the money to pay for assassination. Castillo will now be sentenced on August 3rd. Seven other men have already been convicted and sentenced in the case. Meanwhile, the verdict has been welcomed by indigenous activists and rights groups. People have also renewed their demands for justice for other murdered activists in Honduras. Advocacy group Global Witness has recorded the killings of at least 40 land and environment defenders since 2016. In our next story, we'll look at the ongoing crackdown on Swaziland's pro-democracy uprising. By July 2nd, the political party's assembly had identified at least 43 protesters who had been killed. The identification process has been slowed down due to an internet blackout. Some activists have estimated that the death toll could be at least 70. According to the PPA, around 1,000 people have also been injured. A majority of the casualties were reported on June 29th when security forces opened fire on hundreds of people. Protesters had set fire to properties, vehicles, and businesses owned by King Maswati III. Starting July 1st, protests were largely suspended after the army took over major parts of the country. However, security forces have continued to break into homes and attack people. The PPA has estimated that around 500 people have been arrested. The Communist Party of Swaziland reported on July 3rd that at least 14 people had been injured. The incident took place in a market area in Mashubini. Two people later died due to their injuries. The violence took place just a day before a delegation of the South Africa Development Community reached Swaziland. However, its members did not meet with any of the country's banned opposition parties. Moreover, the SADC's official statement has acknowledged the killing of only one protester. While the meeting was going on, two South African journalists who work with the news website New Frame were detained and attacked near Matsafa. They were threatened at gunpoint and made to delete important footage. They were then taken to a nearby police station where they were beaten and suffocated with plastic bags. The two were finally released on July 5th. In our next story, we go to Indonesia, which is currently facing one of the worst COVID-19 outbreaks in Asia. The country recorded over 31,000 cases and 728 deaths in a 24-hour period as of July 6th. Cases have increased by over four times within the span of a month. The spike has been largely attributed to the Delta variant. However, official numbers are considered to be severely underreported due to poor testing and tracing abilities. The sudden increase has pushed the country's healthcare system near collapse. 63 people died in Java's Sardjito Hospital between July 3rd and 4th. The hospital's oxygen supplies had nearly run out due to a sudden increase in patients. Over a dozen facilities in Surabaya city are now completely full. The government announced on Tuesday that hospitals in the capital of Jakarta were also at 90% capacity. Infections have spread to health workers, while some have collapsed due to exhaustion. As per reports, nearly 1,000 health workers have already died due to COVID-19. As infections continue to rise, the government has diverted all oxygen supplies to hospitals. The country is receiving emergency oxygen and concentrators from Singapore. The government is also trying to source more vaccines. The US has announced that it will send 4 million doses of the Moderna vaccine to Indonesia. The country has heavily relied on China's Sinovac and also received around 5 million doses through COVAX. As of now, only about 5% of Indonesia's over 270 million people have been fully vaccinated. And for our final story, we go to the UK, where fresh protests against the policing bill were held on July 5th. The Police Crime Sentencing and Courts Bill passed its final reading in the House of Commons on Monday. The legislation expands discretionary police powers, including setting time and noise limits on protests. It will also extend stop and search powers and criminalize so-called unauthorized encampments. Activists have argued that these provisions will place more marginalized groups at more risk. The Liberal Democrat Party tabled several amendments to the bill during the Parliament session on Monday. These were aimed at removing the restrictions on processions and protests. However, the amendment was defeated by a majority of 354 to 273 votes. Meanwhile, hundreds of protesters gathered at Parliament Square in London. Here is a video feature on Monday's demonstration.
If people don't have the right to protest, then how can we tell the government that we're not happy with what they're doing? And the protests are peaceful, so there's absolutely no need to say we can't have protests. If we were always violent, that would be another matter. But all the protests are peaceful, so why should they be stopped? Only dictators fear protest.
Must be seen that we the people do not support this bill. It's authoritarian, it's a clampdown on people's civil rights and on democracy itself, because democracy is not just a bunch of old people debating in the House of Parliament, it's about people having their voices heard on the streets.
And that is all the time we have for this episode of the International Daily Roundup. For more such stories and videos, visit our website peoplesdispatch.org, subscribe to our YouTube channel and follow us on Facebook, Twitter and Instagram. Thank you for watching.